Hello, my friend. This is Heather. Welcome, welcome. This week on the Celebrity Chat, I am talking with Linda Katz, and we are talking about emotions, and we are talking about why it's okay that we have all of them. They're not good, they're not bad, they just are, and there's a reason for all of them. And I'm going to invite you to listen and then let me know what you think. I hope you have actually listened to the very end and you'll understand why I'm saying, I hope you have a day. Talk to you soon. Bye-bye. Hi, my friends. Welcome. This is the Back to Me podcast, and this is Heather, and I am super excited that you're here. You are going to hear some tips and some tricks and some ideas to help you live your happiest and healthiest self. I call it Back to Me because when you are taking care of yourself, back to me, then you can take better care of others and we can all make the world a better place. This is Wellness Your Way, and I am super happy that you're here. I love podcasting. Hello, my friend. How are you doing? This is Heather. This is Back to Me podcast. This is Awesome Human Day, and this is the Awesome Human Linda Katz, and we are going to talk about making friends with your emotions, which is interesting because I've been having conversations about good, bad, and ugly, the good, the bad, and the ugly lately. So, Linda, welcome.
Thank you so much. I'm so glad to be here.
Yeah, I'm so glad that we got to connect. And your company is called Singing Bird. Is that right? Mm-hmm.
Yes, Singing Bird Coaching. That was the nickname my mom gave me when I was a little kid because I would always be, I always have a song stuck in my head and I'm always singing something. And so that stuck. And when I was naming my coaching business almost a decade ago, that was what came forth.
That's outstanding. I love that. Yeah. And it actually works really, like, it makes sense for the little bit that I've known you, but it makes sense that that would be your nickname. And yeah. So something that I always am super curious about because I find people so interesting is how did you get into this coaching world? And more specifically, like, because I know that your background is very interesting and what you offer is super interesting. So I'm always excited to know, like, how did this all come about?
Yeah. It's a great question. So I started coaching, I think it was about a decade ago, and I started doing health coaching. And it was a complete pivot for me. I was working in marketing and a corporate job prior to that. I had gone to school for fine arts. And so I always had, like, the creative inklings. But when it came time to find a job, like so many people, my practical side took over. And it was like, well, how do I make a living doing creative things? So I will go into marketing, believing and hoping that it would be close enough to what I was hoping to do. It wasn't. Right. Turns out that it's not quite the same. And so after about, I think it was maybe 7 years or so of working corporate, I started to attend the Institute for Integrative Nutrition. And it was because I had followed a woman in Austin on social media who was doing health coaching. And she was, you know, posting all these pictures of herself on Lady Bird Lake and paddleboarding and eating delicious food. And there was something, and it was like, man, I want that to be my life. I don't want to sit in this gray cubicle all day. I want to also be, you know, have that kind of vibrancy that I felt like she was exhibiting in her photographs. And so I started there, and that was really a huge turning point, not only in my career life, but just for me. I had, prior to that, was very disconnected from my body. Mm. So this was probably the first time of starting to consciously listen to my body and her signals. And from the time of being in high school, having an eating disorder, college, learned about binge drinking, you know, I'd found all of these ways to basically be like, I'm up and out of here. I'm vacating all of the discomfort, the sensation, the emotions that come with being a human being. I was like, I don't want to be a part of it. And obviously, I wasn't aware of that at the time. And it wasn't until I started at IIN, I started to explore different ways of eating. So the way that that program is structured, you basically, you try things on. You try on different types of diets and ways of eating, ways of living, ways of moving. And it was this invitation to start to listen to my body. And so that was kind of my initial doorway into coaching. And as I started to coach people, I realized that I was like, I really don't want to talk to them about food. Right. And no one wanted to talk to me about food. You know, that was kind of the initial way in. But what people really wanted to talk about was, you know, how are they feeling? What was happening in their relationships? What was happening? You know, were they feeling satisfied in the work that they were doing? How did they feel about themselves? And, you know, it was something that like, oh, here's this nice kale salad isn't really going to cut it
right
into that kind of conversation. And so that's when I started to realize that those were the types of conversations that I wanted to be having and that other people wanted to have with me. And so that's when it really transitioned into more of a life coaching model. And it was through my work with my longtime mentor, Leanne Raymond. I remember our first session, I was like, she's just a wise woman extraordinaire, also Canadian. And she, my first session, I was like, this is the type of coaching that I want to be doing. It was unlike anything that I had experienced. And yeah, that was really kind of what set me off on my path.
That's really cool. And it's so interesting that I could see where, you know, when you're in high school, you don't really, or even out of, well, I guess once you get out of college, but I could see where you could see where marketing, you would think would be creative. Like it seems on TV, it seems like they're all very creative, doesn't it?
Yes. Yes.
But then the real life of it is just not the same. It's
no,
kind of a lunch bag letdown.
Exactly. I think it's the, like, I kind of call it now what I see as the difference, even in my own work, of the difference between communication and expression.
Okay.
And so like there's marketing is communication, right? It's meant to convey a message in the same way that me marketing my work now is communication.
Right.
It does not feed enough the need for expression, the need for just that. It doesn't matter how it lands for someone else. It's something within me that wants to find its way out.
Right, which is so different, which is totally different.
Yep.
And it is true. Like, I mean, our trajectories are quite similar. I remember when I took a yoga class, because I was a corporate finance executive, and I took yoga, I was like, what is this? What's going on with this place that I live,
you know? Yes.
Because you do spend all of your time in your head when you're in those roles. And this isn't true for everyone, but I did find, like, once you figure out that your body is talking to you and you're listening, you're thinking, whoa, like, what have I been doing all this time? And
yes.
What have I been avoiding? And I understand that for some people, it's kind of scary to look at it. And I guess that's where you're kind of bridging that gap to help, right?
Yes. Right? Yeah. I think it is. It's, we spend a lot of time, and I think it's very culturally sanctioned as well, that we cut ourselves off from the neck down, that we do herald living in our heads. And that's kind of what is lifted up as a benchmark. And so when we get down into the body, when we get down into sensation, when we get down into emotion, all of these pieces that a lot of times many of us have found ways to not deal with, whether that be through overeating, undereating, overworking, you know, all of the plethora of ways that we can vacate our experience. You know, I also teach a practice called Koya, which is a movement practice. And so often it's very frequent that at first, especially when we start to get into the body, like tears just come. And
Right.
it's, because there is this unfelt world of emotion and of feeling and of sensation that when we tap back into it, it can be scary at first. It can be overwhelming. It's like if we've swept all this stuff under the rug, we're like, there's a certain part of us that's like, I don't want to lift
It's too messy
the rug.
down there.
Yeah, exactly. Like, what am I going to find under the rug? It's taken on a life of its own at this point.
I've created a monster.
Exactly. And so I think the process of what I love to do in my work is to help to be with people as we kind of gently lift the rug, that we don't need to throw the rug off altogether. We can just peek under there and bring in a little bit of light and a little bit of softness and compassion for ourselves. And also, I think what's so important is this compassion for our previous selves who did sweep things under the rug, that was often what was the best choice that was available to us at the time. Because it's so easy too, I think, at least for myself, for a lot of the women that I work with, that inner judgment of like, oh, I did the wrong thing. Like I was looking at our past selves with a lot of judgment rather than seeing that this was the best thing. This was the best that we could do at the time.
And I find like you could definitely compassion for things that you did because that was your capacity. But also, as things come out, and you experience them, being compassionate with yourself that you can have, you don't have to label them as good or bad, or even anything. It's just a thing. I just remember, because I've taught yoga now for 19 years, that yoga is somewhere where people often have emotional things that come out. And sometimes they'll just say, I don't know why. I'm like, it doesn't matter. Like, it's just something you've tucked away and it's just gonna just let it out, like, let it do its thing. And it was interesting what you were saying about, we live from the neck up. We also live in this. I had two thoughts. One is there's this particular fitness company whose logo or its tagline just, irks me a little bit because it's called Make Your Body a Machine, Your Machine. I'm like, no. I know. No, that's not right. You don't just abuse this place you live, right? And my other thought was something else is gone. So we'll talk about that first because it'll come back to me.
Yes, that is. I think that's again that one way that we are taught to relate to our bodies is this, it's very one directional, right? It's top down, it's from the head to the body. I am going to force, I'm going to push, I am going to, no pain, no gain, that kind of
That was
idea
the
that we
80s,
should
man.
run our bodies as if they're machines rather than having this kind of two-way relationship with our body and noticing how our body wants to move, how our body wants to eat, what feels good, what fabrics feel good, like allowing our body to have a voice, I think is so important.
Right. And I will tell, so I just retired from massage therapy, 14 years of being a therapist. And people would often ask, like, why does this hurt? I said it kindly, but it was because you didn't listen to all the other messages. So I view pain as it's information, right? It's not bad or good. It's just information. And it's like you weren't listening, so now I'm gonna start shouting. And I see pain as the body shouting at you to pay attention. And it's, I mean, obviously, if you get hit by a car, it's not the same thing, but it's like, generalizing a little bit. But it is like, it's the only way it doesn't have a language, and the brain thinks it's in charge. But I remember I was quite young. I was a St. John Ambulance cadet, I was a first aider. And one of our instructors said, the brain thinks it's in charge until it's in pain, and then the body's in charge. Right? But you don't want it to have to get to that.
No, and there's so many other options, right? It reminds me of that very famous quote by Mary Oliver from, I think it's Wild Geese, the poem where she talks about, like, you don't have to walk 1,000 miles. I'm going to totally butcher it, but it was basically
like, all the time.
just allow, you know, like the softness of your body to love what it loves. And it's such a different mode of being that so often we do try to whip the body into shape. And what that does, I think, really is also that it severs the trust that we have. It severs the trust in ourselves. It severs the trust that we have with our bodies. Because it's not, we end up creating an environment where it's not a safe place to be in our bodies.
And I think this just twigged into my brain, because often, I know it's not true of everyone, but often your intuition lives in your body. So if so many people are cut off from their intuition, maybe because they've cut themselves off from their body and what the messages are.
Yes. Right? Yes. 100%.
I was just talking intuition with someone recently. So it's like, ooh, the webs are connecting. I can see it now. I remembered the other thing I was thinking about emotions. These days, we do live cerebrally, and we do really, you know, put on a pedestal how big people's brains are, which I think is awesome. But, you know, because I think a lot, but I also take care of where I live. But I was thinking about the good, it's because I'm not going to label them, but label them good versus bad. It's like your social media posting lady. It's like, look, I'm how fabulous my life is, but you don't see the other side because we don't show that side. And that's creating this world, I find, where it's not good to have the other emotions.
Yeah.
Right.
It's basically not okay to be human.
Not okay to have anything but Pleasantville. And we remember what happened in Pleasantville, don't we?
Yeah. And I think it's just social media is a very weird thing that we've created, I think, because then a lot of times I don't think that we're necessarily, you know, oftentimes what feels vulnerable is sharing the truth of our emotions with another living person who is meaningful to us, right? And so oftentimes even vulnerability on social media becomes performative. Right. In some ways, right? Because it's like, well, now I'm trying to prove to you that my life isn't sunshine and rainbows. Right. So I'm going to share with you all. And it's like a very weird and kind of artificial, because it's just an artificial way of being. And I think it's so new. But yeah, you know, there's a lot of, in a lot of different ways, these ideas that basically having anger, grief, disappointment, regret, you know, these kind of things that have no purpose. We believe, right? They have no purpose. They're not moving us forward. So anytime, you know, we experience them, we see it as there being something wrong, right? That there's something that has gone astray, rather than that we are human beings and that sometimes life is painful. Sometimes we don't get what we want. Sometimes something that really matters to us or someone that we really love is injured or passes away. And that there is this whole mechanism that our emotions are really meant to keep us healthy. And they're a part, I think, of what makes us human. And we put a lid on them because we get uncomfortable with it, because there are very few spaces in our modern culture where other people will, you know, can handle us feeling the way that we feel, right? So often it's like, let me say something that'll be like, but everything, you know, this too shall pass. Everything happens for a reason, right? All of these ways that we try to put a lid on someone else's emotion, our own emotion, rather than welcoming it. Because it's like when we welcome it, usually it moves through. And then it's like we get to the other side and there's like that deep sigh. And we can actually then move forward without needing to push or force. It's just that is like the force of nature moving through us.
And I mean, I just think, of course, my God, my brain, like so many ideas are coming through as you're talking. Because I was thinking about part of it is the I mean, we've lost the knowledge of how to hold a space for someone because if we have ours tucked away, I don't want to see yours because it's going to remind me that mine's tucked away, right? So it's like, how do I help you process if I can't process my own? Because we've lost that conversation and that time. And I guess I'm a child of television because I keep thinking of TV shows that I've seen. But do you remember Will and Grace?
Yes, I never watched a lot of them though.
I'm pretty sure it was Will and Grace where she had broken up with a boyfriend and she was depressed, and they were all just like, "Oh, get over it. You didn't need him." But she needed to just lay in her room with the lights out and watch like sad movies or something for 48 hours. But they all went in to try and cheer her up. So they all ended up being depressed. And she got up at the end and went, "I feel okay now." And she left. And they were all just like, "Oh my God, my life sucks."
Yes,
So
because so, yes,
she did
that, sorry.
hers. They weren't done theirs.
Well, yeah, because it's that sense of we try to fix, like when we see that, when we see grief, when we see emotion as a problem, or that there's something that's wrong, we believe that there's something that needs to be fixed,
Right.
whether in ourselves or in someone else, rather than that this is just part and parcel of being human. And can we allow ourselves, can we create these containers for ourselves? Can we, where we can move through, where we can feel? And sometimes there can be that conscious invitation, like one of the, you know, whether it's through art or through dance or movement or putting on, you know, like what I love is she watched sad movies, right?
Yeah.
There's the beauty of putting on, when you feel sad, putting on a movie or a song that mirrors how you feel. Rather than so often, I think it's the impetus is like put on something that's going to cheer you up, right?
Right,
Like
right.
something that will take you out of it. And it's like allowing yourself instead to go into it, to be in that feeling. And I think what we miss too when we don't do that for ourselves and for one another is that meaningful connection. When
Right.
we realize that it's like we all have those experiences. That's like the beauty of listening to a sad song is that you can feel that space in yourself of like, oh, or when you read a book and somebody like tells you what their difficult experience that they went through. And in that process of you don't feel as alone. And it
Right.
actually brings us together as human beings in this beautiful way that I think we miss. When we try to fix ourselves and one another.
Well, and I think that feeling that everybody is perfect except you separates you more. So it's social media, I think, wanted to bring us all together into one big, happy global community, but instead it's created this strange competition of who can be the happiest. But nobody's
Yes.
actually happy all the time.
No.
And the other thing I was thinking of, it's like me and avoiding the emotions that we don't feel like we want to feel, they don't last forever. Like, it's okay to be there and trust that you will go by it, right? It's like
Well, I think
it
in what
has to do what has to do.
happens, yeah, my sense of it too is that like when we don't give ourselves permission to feel it, oftentimes we store it in our body. That
That was the
it
other thought that
ends.
I had, because sometimes I think chronic pain or disease can, and this is controversial, I know, because no one would necessarily, not everyone would agree, but I think that's where some illness comes from,
I definitely
right?
think some does. I don't think it's again, it's like it doesn't have to be the all or nothing. It's like, does that have an effect? I think so often, yes. All the time, maybe not. But it's, I do think that there is something when we don't allow ourselves to feel that it ends up those things, we kind of push them down and we think that they are, by not feeling them, they go away. But it's actually the opposite, right? By
Right.
not feeling them, it's like, we have this giant pack that we're just like carrying with us, like, you know, we're like, we're not going to look at what's back there.
And we talk about people with baggage. So we recognize that people have baggage, but we can't see our own. It's like,
Yes.
no, it's back there. I can't see it. I've tucked it into my backpack.
Yes. Yeah. I think it's instead if we could just give ourselves permission to feel it, I think it also not only impacts our long-term health, our connections, our the meaning that we find in things. It's just I don't know. It feels like it's just a really, to me, emotion and feeling is like a sacred part of humanity that has been denigrated for a long time.
Right, yeah. We have reached this just don't worry, be happy kind of state. And yeah, again, my brain. But before I didn't want to forget because you told me that you have a book. Is it
Yes.
about, it's called Homecoming Tech.
Yeah.
Yes. And
Yep.
what's it about? We
So
didn't we didn't discuss that.
it's part memoir. It's part my story of coming back home to myself, coming back home to the feminine energy, coming back home to my body. And then part of my work of how, how the kind of the heroine's journey, which is typically how I work with women, which I kind of, I see it as that seasonal journey that starts in fall, where like the deciduous trees that we've been taught that we're supposed to be evergreen. And so you have to hold on to your like pine needles for, and withstand all of the cold and, rather than, oh, what if we're actually meant to be more deciduous? And what if we do go through these cycles of death and rebirth? And what does that look like? And so for me, that looked like shedding what I call the patterns of the inner cage, the good girl, the rebel, and the tyrant king. And the good girl, I think, and rebel people are pretty familiar with. Or you can have kind of a sense of who that is. And the Tyrant King for me is kind of our internalized patriarch that promotes productivity at all costs and the ends justify the means and that does tend to break things into these very large all or nothing buckets. And so it's really kind of the story of my story and the story of my work. Of how do we begin to shed those patterns to unearth that inner wise and wild energy that I think we all have within us? And how do we really step into our humanity?
Right. I liked how you described at one point that you were doing work, but you didn't feel like it was wild enough. Is that what, did I say that right? You're just not, I'm not wild enough yet. I'm like, wow. And
Yeah.
what, for you, what is wildness, I guess? What does wildness,
Yeah.
like, what does it look like in your world?
Yeah, I think for me, at first, I'm going to describe the shift, right? Because at first in our social media world, an image saturated world, I had an image of what I thought wild was. And so as I tried to step into that image, it came as a very stark awakening when I realized that I still didn't feel wild. And I was like, but now I am going to the dance and, like swimming in the lake and I quit my job. And why don't I still feel the way that I want to feel? And it was because I was still trapped in these patterns of the good girl. I was still performing. I was still trying to please other people. I was still trying to be who I thought they wanted me to be. It was just that who I tried to please changed. So instead of
Right.
trying to please, my corporate bosses or my colleagues, it was now I was trying to please this more kind of new age hippie community that I was stepping into. And so I had to change the way that I spoke and the way that I dressed. And, I felt like I had to shove my practicality out one door and instead, only become interested in crystals. Like there was no integration of the wholeness of who I am. And so I think that to me is a part of wildness is this, there's a sense of wholeness and there's a sense of integrity. Like when I think of any kind of wild creature, they just are who they are. And I think that to me is the wild, is that sense of just being who we are, allowing for the becoming at the same time, that there is just this sense of isness, this sense of wholeness, a lack of artifice, a lack of performance. That to me is the wild, and it's an ongoing process, right?
I was gonna say, wildness sounds like it's freedom, but I think it's diligence as well in staying true to your values and your own truth, and because it is so easy to fall prey to the I don't have enough subscribers, where are all my likes, like
yes
complaining about algorithms. Anybody who's trying to get more followers on social media is like, oh, the algorithm. Oh, it's like,
how do I play to the algorithm? What do I do? When do I post? What's the right ratio of my face to something else?
How many hashtags? It's like, oh my gosh.
Yes.
But,
yes.
And finding, it's like the integration, finding that way to stay true and be diligent in respecting your awesomeness, because I think all humans are awesome, but and still be allowed to play on the island. You know what I mean? Not be kicked out of the, not be set adrift on an ice floe or something.
Yes, I think that's what we're moving towards, right? And I think that's another way that I sometimes talk about my work, is that healing that rift between authenticity and belonging. Because I think when we're in the good girl, we look for belonging, but we don't find it because we're not authentic. So we just settle for fitting in.
Right.
And when we swing into the rebel, then we are, you know, all like pro authenticity, but it comes with this sense of hardening. It comes with a defendedness, right? That ends up keeping other people away. When a lot of times, like as human beings, I think we very naturally long for some form of belonging and connection with others. And so it's how do we find those communities? How do we create those communities? How do we create those relationships in our lives? And I think that it comes back again to being willing to show up vulnerably in our light and our dark, being able to hold someone else and show up with them in their difficult times, but also being able to celebrate one another in our joys and our successes, right? Because so often it's like we have a hard time with both.
We do.
Right? Like we don't do well with either. We just want everyone like kind of right there in the middle, like, how are you? Life is fine. Things are good. But it's like, let me tell you about everything that's going great in my life. But like, who does she think she is?
Yeah. You know? Oh my God. I can't believe she's telling me that blah, 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 blah. Sure, she can do it.
Yeah, exactly. And then, or it's like, oh, if you tell somebody what's going, like what's been really difficult, oftentimes the impetus is like, oh no, now what do I say? How can I do this? You
exactly.
know, like, why did I ask to begin with?
Yeah, I just wanted to hear you were fine and move on. Have you read the book, The Dark Side of the Light Chasers?
A long time ago.
Right,
like
I know. It's
several
old,
years ago.
It's an older book. Yeah. That's a interesting place to for people to enter into contemplating. I just think of all the land of woo, as one of the coaches that I know calls it. The land of woo is becoming more accepted along with lots of other things. But sometimes I think people who are stuck in the woo are in that same place where they won't see that there's another side to what's going on.
Yes. Yes, right. It's that integration, right? It's not one or the other. It's like, how do we make space for all of these different facets of who we are as human beings? Like, how do we invite them all to the table?
We're not digital. We're analog.
Yes.
That's how I like to think of myself. I'm like, I wiggle myself through the day.
I love that. Yes. Yeah.
So we're going to post this all in the show notes, but people can find your book on all the places that people find books.
Yes.
I guess the best place for them to start is your webpage. Yes.
Yes. Which would be singingbirdcoaching.com. Yeah.
And you also have Do you have something else too? You have a, oh, the training on the inner cage.
Yes. So that's my little freebie, if you will, on my
Yes, love
website.
freebies.
It's, yeah, who doesn't? I'm like, I feel like they've gotten a bad rap recently, but I'm like, hey, it's that if you have an interest or resonate with the good girl, the rebel, or the tyrant king, or you feel like you long for a wild a life that is wilder, and even if you've done some very large changes in your life, but maybe don't feel the way that you want to feel, what I often find is that we tend to break out of the external cages first, because that's what we see in our culture is
Gotta
that,
start somewhere.
Exactly. You got to start somewhere. And it's like when all of those are gone and you still don't feel the way you want to feel, that's when the work begins.
Right.
And it's like, okay, what is going on within me? And so this training, it's a 40-minute training going into really what are, how do I see these archetypes? How do I see these energies that we can tend to inhabit or get stuck in? And that prevent us from moving into that kind of sovereign, authentic, wise, and wild woman place, which is both soft and strong. Right?
That's
That's,
awesome. That's
yeah.
so cool. Yes, I am a huge fan of the freebies. Like every time I see a freebie of something that I mean, if people don't know what a freebie is, it's just like as a, it's something that off, it's often used in the coaching world, although it's used everywhere, you know, it's like to invite you to start to experience what it, this person is about, right?
Yeah.
So like I have a quiz on my website to check, you know, what part of your wellness maybe you need to work on, and 108 ways to wellness, and all these kinds of fun things. I just like the number 108. So yeah, I love to downloads because I always there's always a nugget in there of something,
Yeah.
and it's an invitation to expand and explore more things, right?
Yes, yeah,
So good.
exactly. It's a great way to start to get to know someone too, because I think a lot of times so much of this work, I mean, with coaching is relational. And so it depends on how do you resonate with the person, right?
Yeah.
How it's that relationship, it's that connection that you have,
Yeah.
that I think is part of the magic that can't really be quantified.
No. And you need there's an ener there's definitely an energetic connection with coaching clients that they will either connect with you or not.
Yep.
And it's good to know in advance.
Exactly.
Right.
One of my favorite things I worked with Tad Hargrave was this idea of like the goal of marketing is simply to find out is it a fit? And I was like,
Right.
I love that where it's not because from the tyrant king mode, right? It's either you work to get the client or it's there's something wrong, like I did something wrong or there's something wrong with that, right? Versus oh, this just isn't a good fit. Like, it doesn't have to be anything else. It
Right.
can, that's like a great, I think, metaphor for a lot of relationships in our lives, too. It's like, oh, there's nothing, maybe we just don't resonate, or we do
Yeah.
resonate,
You know, if I live in Florida, I probably don't need a parka, no matter how good your marketing is, right?
Exactly. You're like, and maybe if you're a parka company, just don't keep advertising to Florida.
Exactly. You're not, you're
Spinning
not,
your wheels.
it's not that your marketing is failing, it's just the wrong fit.
Exactly.
Before you go, first, I want to say thank you so much for sharing your wisdom with us and your knowledge and your awesomeness. But I always am interested before we go if you had, we talked about a lot of things, but do you have a final word of wisdom?
Final word of wisdom. I think my final word of wisdom would be, what would it feel like to just give yourself the space to feel how you feel without caveat, without fixing, just with curiosity? Allowing yourself to feel how you feel and just notice what happens.
That's awesome. That's amazing.
Thank you so much. This has been such a joyous conversation. Thank you so
Thank
much for having me.
you. It's such a so great to talk to you. We've talked before, but it's good to catch up with you.
Yeah.
And friends out in podcast land, Have an amazing day. And if you don't have an amazing day, that's okay too, right? No judgment.
You have a day.
You have a day. You do you. That's what I always say at the end of my yoga classes. You do you. And if you learn something new, give us a little comment. Give us a like. Share it with someone who you think would benefit from this, because I think it's always helpful. I always try to give people lots of resources. When I find something, I'm like, oh, this would help you. This would help you. So send it out to the world. And definitely go check out the book and the 40-minute class and see what you feel, right? Take care, my friends. Have an amazing, maybe. Have a day. Talk to you soon.
Hi, my friend. Thanks so much for listening to this entire podcast. If you found it useful and you're like me and you like helping others, please feel free to share this. Just give it a like, give it a comment. If you found something useful in it, there's a chance that someone else will find something useful as well. Also, if you have any questions at all, I can absolutely help, and I would love to help. You can email me at heather@prosperityflowcoaching.com. If you want more of this awesome content, you can follow me on Instagram, Heather Stewart Coaching. You can follow me on Facebook, Prosperity Flow Coaching. And I have a personal request. I want to help as many people as I can with these podcasts. And if you could give me a review, hopefully a good one, if you could share, if you could send this out into the world, I would truly appreciate it. I hope you have an amazing day, and I hope that you find your way to wellness by getting back to me. Take care, my friend.